Hi everyone, in this video I'm going to explain how to read the most common type of railway signalling used in the state of Victoria, which is three-position colour light signalling. We're going to take a look at what the different signal aspects mean, the role they play around the network, and why it can be useful to know a bit about them as a passenger. Unlike road signals, which have broadly the same meaning wherever you go, railways all over the world use very different systems with very different meanings. Here in Australia, we even have different systems in different states with conflicting meanings, which I've already made a video specifically about. The three-position signalling used in Victoria is a type of speed signalling derived from North American concepts and was first introduced to the Melbourne suburban area in 1915, becoming widespread throughout the early 20s. Today it's used across the whole suburban area, except for a small patch at Frankston, as well as on most regional main lines. Other areas use the much simpler two-position signalling, which will be a topic for another time. Before we get stuck into it, I think this video needs a quick disclaimer. Railway signalling is really complicated and is the most important part of safely operating a railway. I make these videos for fun. I'm not a professional, I don't work in the rail industry. While I do make every effort to make my videos accurate, if you're learning signalling for a safety critical role, please make sure you do it from official sources. The aim of this video is to teach enthusiasts and curious members of the public what signals mean, and it doesn't attempt to cover everything there is to know about signalling. If it did, we'd be here all day. With that out the way, let's get started. Three-position signalling looks very confusing to the untrained eye, and it's easy to overthink it with so many different combinations of lights. However, once you understand the basic principles, it's actually much simpler than it looks. All signals used in three-position signalling are made up of two lights, which are always illuminated. Certain signals also feature a third light, which is normally off. More on that later. This type of signalling originally used motor-operated upper quadrant semaphore signals, of which only a handful remain operational today, preserved on the Puffing Billy Railway. All examples on the main network today are electronic colour light signals. Each signal broadly tells drivers of approaching trains two things: whether it's safe to proceed, and at what speed. As with most types of signalling, three colours are used: green, yellow, and red. Before we get into the complexity of the multi-light aspects, we need to understand what the colours mean individually. Red, unsurprisingly, means stop. I don't think that needs much elaboration. Yellow means warning. A warning aspect tells you that the signal after this one is at stop. Unlike road vehicles, trains are frequently unable to stop within their own line of sight, so getting a warning about a stop signal ahead is very important. Train drivers are required to have extensive route knowledge, including knowing the location of every signal, so when they see a warning aspect, they'll know exactly how far they have to go before the red signal ahead. Finally, we have green, which means clear. This means it's safe to proceed past this signal and the next one. We know the next signal won't be red, because if it was, this one would be showing warning. It's important to note that the term proceed applies to any aspect other than stop, so a signal is either at stop or proceed. Typically speaking, and this is a very general thing that applies to most signalling systems worldwide, as a train passes a green signal, it drops back to red, protecting the train from any following movements. The gap between each signal is called a block, and as the train enters the next block, the signals behind will clear, allowing a following train to proceed. If the second train starts catching up on the first train, it will see a warning signal and prepare to stop before the red signal, protecting the train ahead. Depending on the location, most places will keep trains separated by one full block, so there will actually be two red signals behind each train. So now we know what the three colours mean, we need to look at the other piece of the puzzle, which is how these signals indicate speed. And this is where the two lights of our signal come into play. When the signal is at stop, both lights are red. When the signal changes to proceed, one of the lights will change to yellow or green. The top light indicates normal speed. Normal speed is just the line speed limit, so a train can pass a signal showing normal speed at the maximum permitted speed for that location and train type. The bottom light indicates medium speed. Medium speed is 40 kilometers per hour, although it can also be 65 or 80, which is displayed by an illuminated number attached to the signal. But by default, a medium speed signal should be passed at 40 k's an hour, and that speed restriction applies until the train reaches the next signal. Now, if we combine those two concepts together, we get the complete meaning of these colour combinations. Green over red is clear normal speed. Because the light is green, we know we can pass this signal and the next one. And because that green light is on top, we know we can proceed at full line speed. This is the least restrictive aspect in Victorian signalling. Yellow over red is normal speed warning. The yellow light tells us we need to prepare to stop at the next signal, but the fact it's on top tells us we can still proceed at line speed until the driver judges it's time to slow for that red signal ahead. Red over green is clear medium speed. The green light tells us we can proceed past this signal and the next one, but the fact it's on the bottom light tells us we must do so at no more than 40 kilometers per hour. Red over yellow is medium speed warning. The yellow light tells us the next signal is at stop, and its position on the bottom tells us to proceed at no more than 40 kilometers per hour. Now, there's one more common aspect that links all these together, and it's the only aspect that involves both green and yellow, with one small exception which I'll get to later. This is reduced to medium speed. It tells us that this signal can be passed at normal speed, but the next signal is at medium speed. So essentially it tells the driver to reduce the train's speed down to 40 kilometers per hour by the next signal. If the medium speed signal ahead is a 65 or 80 medium speed, that number will be displayed next to the reduced to medium signal as well. So are you confused yet? A lot of people overthink this by always thinking of each aspect as a combination of two colors. And certainly the normal way of describing these aspects is green over red, red over yellow, etc. But in reality, the red light is just a reference point to show the position of the other light. It all becomes a lot simpler if you think of clear normal speed as top green, or medium speed warning as bottom yellow. And then if you see both yellow and green, that'll be reduced to medium. Going back to overanalyzing again, the reason this aspect uses those two colors makes sense on a light-by-light basis. The normal speed light is showing the warning colour, in this case a warning that normal speed running will shortly come to an end, while the medium speed light assures us that we're all clear to proceed past the next signal at that reduced speed. But again, there's really no need to think about it that deeply. At this point, I should say, if all you want to know is what the combinations of lights mean and you don't want to get into crazily specific detail, you could probably tune out now, but there's still a lot to cover, so if you want to know more, please stick around. An important thing to note is that some signals operate automatically, while others are controlled manually by a human signaller. Manually controlled signals are called home signals and exist in places where there are junctions, sidings, or crossovers. Basically, anywhere where you might potentially encounter another train coming from the other direction or crossing over your track. You can tell the signal is a home signal by its lights being in straight vertical alignment, while automatic signals have their lights offset diagonally. Auto signals exist midsection, in places where trains can only follow one another in the same direction. They automatically change to proceed once the block ahead is clear. Because there's no risk of encountering a train coming in the other direction, automatic signals can be passed at stop under certain conditions, which helps keep traffic moving when a signal fails. This allows a train to cautiously continue forward to the next signal or until encountering the rear of a train ahead. Home signals, on the other hand, can never be passed at stop without verbal permission from the signaller. Many automatic signals look like this, with a normal-sized top light but just a little red marker light on the bottom. This means that the signal is in a location where it never needs to show medium speed, so the bottom light is just permanently red. Some home signals can be temporarily switched out to operate automatically, and these display an illuminated A under the lights when in automatic operation. On the flip side, there are some signals which operate automatically but are to be treated as home signals, as in they look like home signals and therefore can't be passed at stop without permission. These tend to exist in places where a collision could be particularly disastrous, like in the city loop or on the elevated skyrail sections. Okay, so under what circumstances will a signal show medium speed? There are two main applications. First is when taking a diverging route at a junction. Most junctions clearly have a straight direction and a curved direction, and generally speaking, the home signal protecting the junction will show normal speed for straight ahead or medium speed for the diverging route. There are some exceptions to this. For instance, where the curve speed is equal to or lower than the line speed, then a normal speed signal may be shown. I can think of two examples of this at Ashburton and Wattle Glen. But at the vast majority of junctions, the speed indication on the signal will tell you which route is set for the approaching train. A good example of this is at Clifton Hill, where the signal for down trains departing platform 2 will always show a normal speed aspect for the Mernder line and always show a medium speed aspect for the Hurstbridge line. However, it's worth keeping in mind that while the route ahead can be inferred from this with local knowledge, it's not actually what the signal means. It tells the driver what speed to travel at, but it doesn't actually specify a route. The other common application of medium speed is in places where signals are spaced closely together, where a bottom yellow, medium speed warning, will be shown before a red signal, preventing a train approaching the red at full line speed. This also provides one extra step of warning to the driver, because they will first see a reduced to medium aspect, then a medium speed warning, before finally approaching the signal at stop. The same thing is sometimes used when approaching a red signal at a junction to slow the train's approach, reducing the risk of overshooting into said junction should things go pear-shaped. Right, so given the signals themselves don't definitively show what route is set ahead, how do drivers know which way they're being sent? Well, In some cases, they don't, particularly entering large stations like Flinders Street or the country platforms at Southern Cross. There are plenty of situations where the train will get a medium speed aspect which could apply to several different platforms. Something that's becoming much more widespread in recent decades, however, is the use of route indicators. These give a clear indication to the driver what route has been set ahead, and importantly, give them a chance to question it with the signaller if it's not the route they were expecting. Route indicators take many forms. Some of the early types are just simple arrows. There are these feather indicators, although I think the only remaining example is this one on the Up Sandringham line at Richmond. Someone will definitely tell me if there's any others I've missed. There's also this super budget type consisting of just painted arrows on the signal target plates. In this case, you certainly can rely on the speed indication to also specify the route. But the most common type today are these ones, consisting of a large illuminated letter. These usually require some local context to understand, with the letter usually standing for a line name or a prominent destination. Some also show M or R for metro or regional, in places where those trains are separated. A close relative of the route indicator is the dual gauge indicator. These are used on sections of dual gauge track to assure the driver that the correct route is set on the correct gauge, something you really don't want to get wrong. They show an illuminated S for standard gauge or V for broad gauge. I'm guessing a B would have looked too similar to an S, so they went with V for Victoria instead. So going back a bit, what's that little bottom light I mentioned earlier? This is the low speed light, which illuminates yellow. The low speed aspect is quite different to all the others. It permits a train to proceed at no more than 15 km per hour, but the section ahead may be occupied, so the driver must be able to stop short of any obstruction. You'll most often see a low speed light when a train is entering a siding or yard, and there are lots of places where a train will enter a long siding which already contains another train, hence the need to be able to stop within a short distance. There are also some instances where multiple trains will be allowed onto a single platform, so the second train arriving would need a low speed aspect to enter the occupied block. You will see this sometimes at Southern Cross and also at Frankston, where the two-car Stony Point train often shares platform 2 with a suburban train. Low speed lights are also used when coupling two trains or two parts of a train together, and you'll commonly see this at Southern Cross when locomotives come in from the yard to couple to their passenger cars, or when multiple rail car sets are combined together. A variation of the low speed light is the humble dwarf signal, which is usually found in sidings protecting access back out onto the main line, or in places where a shunt might occur on the main line. Dwarf signals show red for stop, but some types actually show blue for stop, which is just an alternative to red and helps visually separate them from other signals. Now, before anyone leaps into the comments to correct me, I'm well aware that in the rulebook this colour is described as purple, and the old incandescent signals did look purple, but modern LED versions appear very much blue. Most dwarf signals can only show one aspect other than stop, which is a single yellow light, having the same meaning as a low speed light on a home signal. While we're talking colour, I'm also aware that many yellow signal lights are arguably orange, but the official description of them is yellow. Some dwarf signals can show a third aspect consisting of a single green light, and this is clear low speed. Basically, the 15 km per hour speed restriction still applies, but you can expect the section ahead to be unoccupied. Signals are usually positioned on the left-hand side of the track they apply to, although they can also be on the right. In places with bidirectional signalling, allowing trains to travel in either direction on either track, you'll see two signals next to each other, one for each track. This is most useful when you want to have a race. But there's another common reason to have a signal on both sides of the line, and that's when one of them is a coacting signal. Coactors just repeat the aspect of the main signal, but from a position that can be seen from further away. Here at Westgarth, the main signal is the one on the left, and its aspect is repeated by the coactor on the right. This line isn't bidirectional, so it can't be confused as applying to the other track. In the case of Westgarth, the tightly curved platform means the main signal can't be seen until the train is quite close to it, but the coactor can be seen from much further back around the curve. Here's another one at Heidelberg, again with the coactor on the right. Another common type is found at the end of platforms, like this example at North Richmond. The main signal is fairly high up, designed to be seen by approaching trains, but will be out of view when the train stops right at the end of the platform. So this little coactor is positioned down at windscreen level for the driver to check before departing. On some examples of this type, the coactor is quite large, like this example at Diamond Creek, which makes the whole thing look like a big four-light signal. Another method of increasing the sighting distance of a signal is the use of a banner indicator. These are positioned some distance before the signal, usually before a curve blocking its view. They use a series of white lines to replicate the colours of the signal, with horizontal for red, 45 degrees for yellow, and vertical for green. A banner indicator is not a signal itself, so if it's showing two horizontal lines, red over red, you don't have to stop at it. It's just warning you what the signal around the corner is showing. A fun fact about these indicators is that the angles of the lines mimic the positions of an upper quadrant semaphore arm. I do need to provide an honourable mention to one other type of signal that is pretty uncommon these days but worth pointing out to avoid confusion. Repeating signals are usually found at the transition between two position and three position signalling territory and exist to provide an advance warning of the first three position signal ahead. They can't show stop and only tell us if the next signal is at proceed or not. The easiest way to think about a repeater signal is that the top light shows either clear or warning and the bottom light is fixed at yellow, although some examples can also show reduced to medium speed. So a warning aspect on a repeater signal is yellow over yellow, while the clear aspect is green over yellow. That's the opposite way around to a reduced to medium aspect. There are only two of these signals anywhere near Melbourne. There's this one approaching Craigieburn from the northeast main line and one at the down end of Frankston. All other remaining examples are out in the country. So is there any benefit to understanding this stuff as a passenger? Well, probably not most of the time, but there are cases where it does come in handy. Most importantly, to impress your friends. Secondly, it can provide you with useful information in cases where the normal passenger information isn't functioning. You know those days where everything's going wrong, all the displays just say listen for announcement and there aren't any announcements? Using my Clifton Hill example from earlier, if that's the case and the train rolls in with something unhelpful on the destination board, you can still be sure which line it's going to take based on the signal aspect. Another common scenario is if you're at a station with two platforms, there are two trains sitting there, both heading in the same direction, and nobody's saying which one is departing first. This is common at lots of terminus stations like Glen Waverley, Belgrave or Werribee, but can happen anywhere where trains departing multiple platforms merge into a single track. No matter what the announcements or displays say, if you see one of the signals change to proceed, that's the train that's departing first. I can think of several occasions where a signal aspect has told me what is happening long before any official information has been announced. On a normal operating day at North Melbourne, you'll often get two city loop trains simultaneously arrive on platforms 1 and 3, but those two tracks merge into one shortly afterwards, and again, the signals will often be the easiest way to tell which train is going to be sent out in front. Now, we're almost at the end of the video, but there's one more thing I probably need to mention. As we speak, the Melbourne Metro Tunnel is nearing completion, and this is going to introduce an entirely new type of signalling to the network. The tunnel is going to carry the Pakenham, Cranbourne and Sunbury lines and will be operated exclusively by the purpose-built HCMT trains. The HCMTs will operate using something called Communications-Based Train Control, or CBTC. This allows trains to travel closer together by doing away with line-side signals entirely. Instead, the system accurately tracks the position of each train and a virtual moving block follows the train, rather than the usual fixed blocks found between signals. This means trains can always follow one another at the minimum safe distance, regardless of their position, and automatically allows slower moving trains to come closer together. So you can expect to see that happening on those lines in the very near future. So that's it. I mean, it's not it, there's lots more that can be said about a topic as complex as this, but it's as far as I'm going to go in this video. In my experience, most people think that the first signalling system they learn makes the most sense, and all other systems are insane, so I have no doubt that the comments will fill up with people telling me that this is all crazy and Sydney's system is inherently better. I personally think the simplest and most concise type of signalling is the one used in the UK. I have made some explainers on both those systems, which I'll put a link to in the video description. If you enjoy this kind of content and would like to support the channel, please check out my Patreon, where you can get some behind-the-scenes content and early access to videos. Thanks very much for watching.